Good evening. My name is Christopher Adams. I'm the rector of St. Paul's College and chairperson of the board of directors of the Arthur B. Morrow Center for Peace and Justice, which is part of St. Paul's College here at the University of Manitoba. Before we begin, I want to state that St. Paul's College, the University of Manitoba, and our city of Winnipeg sit at the crossroads of the Anishinaabe, Métis Cree, Dakota, Oji Cree nations. I wish to acknowledge specifically that we are in Treaty 1 territory and on the traditional lands of the Anishinaabe peoples and the homeland of the Métis Nation. We are committed to the pathways of reconciliation, and we hope all those in this room are able to join St. Paul's College and the University of Manitoba in these endeavors. I join with my colleagues at the Arthur B. Morrow Center for Peace and Justice and the University of Manitoba in welcoming Professor John Packard, who will be giving the 2016 St. Paul's College University Affiliation Lecture, sponsored by Aikins Law. An excellent choice to be our 2016 lecture. We will hear a little more about Professor Packard in a few moments. I won't take too long. And when he's introduced by Dr. Karen Busby. This is the 9th year that the St. Paul's College Affiliation Lecture has been given. This lecture series brings together faculty and students in the fields of peace and conflict studies and related disciplines to share ideas and pursue relationships that further this field of study and research. The lecture series provides an open, public forum for ideas and conversation, and we welcome students, faculty, and members of the public who have joined us today. Please be advised that this event will be videotaped, as you can see by the machine there. And before we go further, I want to express our deep gratitude and thanks for our sponsors and partners. We would like to thank Dr. Sean Byrne, the director of the Morrow Center, for his leadership regarding this series. We wish to thank Zaina Latvia, Dr. Latvia, as the director of the Peace and Conflict Studies program, and the continued support that we receive from the PACS program for this lecture. We wish to acknowledge the efforts of the Peace and Conflict Studies Students Association in planning this morning's student colloquium with Professor Packard. We acknowledge PACS, Peace and Conflict Studies Students Association. We acknowledge the association, the president, Bonfast BT, for his leadership, and in particular those students who had an active role in organizing the event today, Christina Warner, Christina Renke, and the other members of the association executive. And we thank all of the student presenters who participated this morning here at St. Paul's College. We also acknowledge the ongoing funding support of Aikins Law for this lecture series. This well-recognized Winnipeg-based law firm has been a longtime supporter of the Morrow Center's activities and a founding sponsor of this lecture series. We are pleased that Tom Dooley, who is a partner with the firm, who is a college friend and a longtime member of the board of directors, is here to moderate the question and answer session that follows the lecture. Finally, I would like to recognize the continued support of the University of Manitoba for St. Paul's College and the Morrow Center and this lecture series. The university's five-year strategic plan calls us to forge connections that foster high-impact community engagement, both locally and internationally, unquote. We know this lecture series and the graduate student roundtable that was held earlier today, together, these things are helping to build local and international relationships, both now and in the future. We've invited Dr. Karen Busby to introduce our guest speaker. Just briefly, for those who do not know Dr. Busby, she has been with the University of Manitoba's Faculty of Law since 1988. She is the founding academic director of the Center for Human Rights Research. She has a Juris Doctorate from the University of Manitoba and Master of Law from Columbia University. She was called to the Manitoba Bar in 1982, followed by practicing with Thompson, Dorfman, Swetman. She was also the first clerk to serve with the Federal Court of Appeal from 1984 to 1987. The college and a number of university faculties are collaborating with Dr. Busby in having the University of Manitoba create a Master of Human Rights. Please welcome Dr. Busby.
So it's my pleasure to introduce to you Dr. John Packard, the 2016 St. Paul's College University Affiliation Lecturer. This lecture series is intended to foster dialogue and collaboration between PAC students and faculty faculty from related programs at other universities around the world. Given his experience and his generous and collaborative approach to research and advocacy, Dr. Packer is an ideal candidate to deliver this lecture, the capstone of what has been an active and amazing day for students here inside the PACS program. Dr. Packer is an associate professor of law and the director of the Human Rights Research and Education Center at the University of Ottawa. He's previously held academic positions at a number of universities, including University of Essex and at Tufts, and fellowships at both Cambridge and Harvard University. He's also the associate editor of the Human Rights Law Journal and a general editor of the European Yearbook of Minority Issues. However, Dr. Packard is not content to survey the world just from the ivory tower. He is an experienced practitioner with over 20 years' experience working for intergovernmental organizations. He has, for example, investigated serious human rights violations in a number of countries, including extrajudicial executions, arbitrary detentions, and forced disappearances. Most recently, he has worked on the United Nations standby team on mediation experts, advising on peace processes and political transitions around the world, focusing on conflict prevention and resolution, diversity management, constitutional and legal reform, and the protection of human rights, including minorities. This work will be his focus this evening. So here to unpack, if you'll pardon the pun, the role of human rights and peace and conflict studies is Professor John Packer. Please join me.
Thank you so much for those kind and warm remarks. Mr. Rector, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, friends. First of all, let me thank you for that warm introduction, but I must correct one thing that in full disclosure, I never finished my doctorate. So I'm not Dr. Packer. You can call me Professor Packer, but mainly you can just call me John. In fact, I was working my doctorate for a few years in Geneva, and then things changed in the world. And I was recounting to students today that perversely, and it is a perverse world, that my life changed the day that Saddam Hussein invaded Kuwait on the 2nd of August, 1990. And I was studying in Geneva at the time. And strangely enough, there was an urgent need to have someone who had some concentration in public international law, and specifically the international protection of human rights, who was immediately available, had a decent nationality, not one involved in the region, happened to be male. It's the only time that being male, English, and Canadian was really particularly helpful, so that I could visit a number of camps in certain countries where it wasn't easily accessible to prisons and other such institutions. And on that basis, I got a phone call amidst my studies. Could I start work the next day? And by the way, that's how things happen. And I said, no, but I can come the next day. And I did. And that began what became almost 30 years of professional work. It's my great pleasure and tremendous honor to address you here today, this evening. And thank you very much for the special opportunity. Insofar as St. Paul's College is my alma mater, and it's also a place of special memories and influence for and upon me, I hope you'll allow me a few personal remarks before commencing the substantive part of my address. I have to immediately observe that I owe a debt of gratitude to St. Paul's and to the Jesuit community of Winnipeg, who shaped not only my education but my personal development already at St. Paul's College. And I'm very honored to see Mr. Larry Franz here, one of my high school teachers at that time. I had the tremendous good fortune of many wonderful teachers. Not least, I'll mention a few, Richard Grover, Johnson Smith, Father Eric Jensen, who influenced a lot of my development and thinking. I have to say Mr. Franz influenced me too. He doesn't quite know this, but he generously gave me a mark of 51% in physics in grade, I think, 10, which I understood. In fact, I think you more than hinted was actually a light post to say don't continue in that field, which I didn't. I continued in other fields. I also met a number of wonderful people, a number of friends, classmates who are here today, debating partners, Chris and others, and in my 1974 grade 9 class. Sean, I remember our debating days. While I didn't perhaps then know or appreciate it, I was introduced at the time to critical analysis, to Cartesian logic, to mystic epistemology, and the good times of the debating team, which is not a joke. We had some good times. Indeed, I learned to sharpen my thoughts and to construct and articulate an argument, which has helped me ever since. Upon graduation, I came to this college, and I enjoyed my first course on human and civil rights, then taught by the late Professor Marek Dubinsky. And I honed my bridge game, which Father Maricelvi had taught me in high school. Spent a lot of time in the cafeteria playing bridge at that time. And where I met and eventually married in this college in the chapel, here with Father Jensen, my wife Corinne, on 26 August 1988, which I'm told in Chinese numerology is the second luckiest day of the last century. So I've been told, and so my wife reminds me. of course, it's true. I've been amazingly fortunate, good health, work of my own choosing, fine friends, loving family, and a fortunate life it's been. Along the way, St. Paul's has remained in me, and it's been a light to guide me, transcending time and space. So I thank St. Paul's, all of St. Paul's, for that. And now this evening, over 30 years since I left Winnipeg and Canada, I'm back to share some of what I've learned. Today, I enjoyed a rich exchange this morning with the postgraduate students of the Peace and Conflict Studies program, thanks to Sean, where is Sean? Sean Byrne and to Jason, wherever Jason is, for having helped organize this morning, and to the Students Association. This was a fabulous development. It was a great day, but a fabulous development I'd like to congratulate you on, not only for the Moral Center, but to all those who conceived and established it and now foster this important institution at the center of the college. In fact, I would have probably chosen that area of study if it had been available at the time. There's much more I could share, but that's not what I've been invited to address, and that's not why you've come this evening. So thus, I turn to the substantive topic of my address, which is the role of human rights in peace and conflict studies. And let me state immediately some of the definitions on which I'll rely this evening. I'm assuming that not many people in this room are hot on the edge of their seats on this topic of human rights and conflict and peace studies. So I'll share a few thoughts on them after I define them. So by human rights, I mean the really existing and now fat catalog of norms and standards, as well as instruments and mechanisms, which have been widely, if variously, pronounced and created, notably in the last century, by intergovernmental organizations, above all by the United Nations, but also by many regional and other organizations, and increasingly within the constitutional frameworks of both existing and emerging states or de facto authorities. I refer thus to those human rights which have been declared in positive international and domestic law and politics, not the things we dream about or fantasize, but what are actually in black letter instruments. I will be happy to discuss the historical and theoretical foundations of these in a question or answer period, but that's not the topic of my address, nor is it my principal preoccupation. I take it as given that we now live in a world in which there is a substantial catalog of really existing international human rights. It's important, as important as I know it is in for the evolving global order of sustainable peace and justice to rely upon human rights, it's also important that the invocation of these claims for human rights is not fading with time, but appears to be becoming louder, richer in variation, and more articulate. All the more universal in geographic and cultural expression, as more groups claim degrees of ownership, and even more orthodox forms of expression as an accepted element of contemporary international relations and politics. This is notwithstanding evident pushback and a current penchant for dismissive declarations that we now have the end of human rights, human rights are relative, and so forth. From the UN Charter, the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, and myriad other instruments, there is no shortage of such norms and standards, and they have ever-increasing specificity and ever more elaborate jurisprudence. Moreover, already 15 years ago, one scholar, Hurst Hannum of the Fletcher School, observed that no less than 3/4 of all states now incorporate the Universal Declaration of Human Rights in one way or another within their constitutions. So we can be quite concrete and specific about what human rights mean today. By peace, I mean not only the absence of war or even the absence of violence, but the organization of society or societies, including global politics, around good governance, which reliably manages, if not resolves, conflicts of various kinds and permits resilience and foreseeability so that we may plan our lives, satisfy our needs, invest in our interests, and pursue our aspirations along with those of others. Yes, for the students of peace and conflict studies, I'm relying here on the insights of Johann Galtung in the negative versus positive senses of peace, which he postulated, and I build upon these. But to be clear, I'm not this evening or in my work concerned so much about peace of mind or the individual pursuit or enjoyment of happiness, although some people are, and although some people here know that I'm not against the pursuit of happiness. By conflict, I mean essentially disputes. Clashes of needs, interests, or aspirations, which are facts of life in a world of scarce resources, of differences in views, of variety of tastes, over which people will assert their positions and bring their claims. But I'm here really interested not in just disputes, but notably those between groups, including states, which become violent in an organized way. That is, armed conflicts in whatever contemporary manifestations interfere with or jeopardize peace in both their negative and positive senses. By conflict, peace and conflict studies, this field to which we've made reference, I mean the relatively young and developing field of scholarly research and reflection, mainly of the social sciences, but not only, about conflicts and peace in the senses that I've just mentioned, negative or positive, and which concerns itself with the structural nature of conflict, as well as practical and effective means by which armed conflict in particular, and political violence more generally, can be overcome, managed, and hopefully prevented as a means towards a more desirable human condition. And finally, by the role of human rights in peace and conflict studies, I mean the place and the function of human rights in contributing to the field of research and practice, both theoretically, pedagogically, and in terms of outputs. In other words, to which extent is human rights considered by peace and conflict studies, and how is it understood and incorporated in research, teaching, and practice? What utilities are gained by it. In perspective, like the elements I've just defined, I take a universal approach, transnational, global and geographic terms. And despite the important and merited distinctions or nuances informed by area studies and various disciplines and experiences, I'm looking at the world as a whole. I also do not hesitate to observe some empirical realities in law and in fact, notably that despite assertions and utopian aspirations, it's necessary for us to know that not all humans have, much less enjoy, the same human rights. Rather, these depend on applicable law, policy, and practice. Where you are and the quality of government to which you are subjected determines which rights you really enjoy. As such, the postulate of universality is problematical, to say the least. Now, beyond the noted definitions and a word I've shared about approach, you may well ask, so why do we care? Aside from curiosity about the world in which we live, and perhaps the accident of birth and the relative vulnerabilities of uncertainty of life, there but for the grace of God go I. I venture to suggest that we have moral and practical reasons to care. In the first place, indisputably and increasingly, we live in a complex, interdependent world. In evidence through the environment, globalized economy, speed and effects of epidemics, migration, communications, and so much more. We are unavoidably part of this world, a village of interactions from which we benefit and suffer, or are at risk of doing so. More so, we are not passive observers, but active agents to varying degrees, as consumers, producers, voters, even tourists, as parents, friends, and members of a range of communities. Simply, we inescapably carry some degree of responsibility in the sense that we are confronted with facts and possibilities of our own agency in terms of how we choose to respond or not to respond to the effects and outcomes. I was once reminded by a friend with whom I studied that the root of the word responsibility is to respond. It's in this reality, to choose not to respond is simply to accept or even to permit no less an act of agency. Let me push this a step further. We must care because we can make a difference for ourselves and for others. which should be compulsion enough for omission is tantamount to negligence. Now let me add the obvious. The stakes are getting higher. A couple generations ago, we didn't so much know, much less care. But revolutions, international telecommunications developments, and the complex interdependency at hand through travel, movement, have brought right before our eyes instantly all manner of human pain, suffering, and indignities. And it's not just we who are viewing this. While we declare equal human rights for everyone, in fact, our lives are far from equal. Life expectancy in Japan is now some 84 years, while in Sierra Leone, it is half that at some 42 years. And the problem, ladies and gentlemen, is that the people of Sierra Leone know it. What, therefore, is the quality of our declarations? What kind of integrity do we possess in maintaining the assertion in the face of hard facts about which we do nothing or little? Simply, there is a yawning and apparent gap between our declarations and the facts on the ground. That is more than an inconvenient inconsistency. It's a moral and political challenge around which we seek to organize our world. How do we respond? So how does this relate to peace and conflict studies? Unlike most of human history, we have at hand a dedicated field of research from which we can know better, to think and act better in tackling violence and hopefully reducing, if not eliminating it. That is hopeful indeed. It promises an improved human condition, a better way of living, not only for ourselves, but in general. I care because I seek a better world for myself and for others, and I'm interested to know how to achieve it. Allow me a few thoughts about the field as I understand it, and admittedly, I'm not an expert in peace and conflict studies as a field of research. Let me share immediately with you, much more so as a practitioner than a scholar, that in my experience, those practicing real international politics, whether through coercive or non-coercive means, more so coercive than non-coercive, they hardly know or care about the field of peace and conflict studies. That's a hard fact to all our detriments. And so something that we also need to change. We need to enlighten them to the insights of peace and conflict studies. Indeed, it is a fact of international peace mediation, which I maintain a practice, that fully half of all peace processes which succeed in achieving negotiated settlements subsequently fail to maintain the negative peace, meaning absence of war, within 5 years. Half of them fail within 5 years. And even worse, and while we haven't been too effective lately in making peace, we have been even worse in maintaining it, despite what we have been collectively learning. This needs to change. We must get better. We had thought it was changing. Just a few years ago, many were bolstered by the reporting of the Human Security Report conducted out of Simon Fraser University, which was then showing a marked decline in organized violence in terms of armed conflicts. And rather explaining that correlation, observable correlation, with peace processes as causal in nature, although they've been somewhat quiet in the last few years as many processes have failed. I have my own explanations for this, which is partly the motivation for this speech. But certainly there is substantial chagrin in the field of practice about failures in, for example, South Sudan, Libya, Bosnia-Herzegovina, almost the entire Middle East, North Africa, all of the Arab Spring, and so much more. And frankly, there is now fear as long-term projects like the European Union begin to fray amid the specter of returning aggressive nationalism, failed humanitarian principles, and passivity or outright hostility of so many. I'm not so pessimistic. I'm rather optimistic about the future. But I cannot ignore. In fact, we should not ignore or be complacent about these realities. I'm going to make a few references to peace and conflict studies just to show that I've actually paid a bit of attention to it. I've had the good fortune, in fact, to not only become familiar with, but to actually work with a number of leading figures in the field. I'll mention some of them, known to those in the room. Johan Galting, Elise Boulding, John Burton, John Paul Lederach, Herb Kelman, Kevin Clements, Nihan Rahana, Eileen Babbitt, Connie Peck, most of whom have contributed in their own professional experience to various peace processes. But the group is still relatively small. It's still a young field. It's principally comprising social psychologists, some political scientists, a couple of psychiatrists. Of these, also people like Volkan, Dr. Connie Peck, the development of the field of political psychology, in particular by Burton and others. It's unclear to me exactly what is the basis of their theory of change. That is to say, beyond a dialogue or a dialogic approach, a methodology of problem solving, there's some sense that through logic, discernment of causation, through identification of pathways and options, that those who are involved in peace conflict situations will choose the better path. There's another group involved in negotiation, notably those of the Project on Negotiation at Harvard University, such as Roger Fisher, Bill Udry, and others. You might be familiar with the little booklet, Getting to Yes. On the whole, these are either those involved in trade-offs in negotiations or follow a bottom-up approach. And in mediation talk, track two and track three, or sometimes hybrid negotiations of those on the ground or those with experts, but not a top-down approach. It's often understood as generating options with the hope that this will generate resolution of conflicts. My experience, my professional experiences is largely the opposite. My professional experience has largely been top-down or track one, dealing with officials, those who hold specific responsibility, decision makers. But in my work on human rights, I've had the special privilege of engaging with, of working for, of interviewing a variety of victims, a variety of human rights defenders, and trying to seek resolution of their situations in almost impossible contexts. And there's a problem at that level too. What is the theory of change there? In the context of human rights, the theory of change, one of the theories of change, a dominant one, groups like Amnesty International, Human Rights Watch, and so forth, is the so-called mobilization of shame. That if we reveal to those people of good mind and sound moral that such conduct is occurring, that people will rise to the occasion and change their behavior. Or that they will be threatened into such a change of behavior because they fear the sanctions that could be generated increasingly through international criminal law or similar references. But ladies and gentlemen, I'm sorry to tell you that there is an increasing number of shameless people in the world. There are those who not only are not subject to shaming, but stand in the face of that fiercely and oppositionally in the assertion of their right to do harm. Now, I'm not one who says that all conflicts are resolvable. I'm not one who says that we should demur in the face of resistance. And I do believe that we should follow our own moral compasses in the pursuit of truth, reconciliation, and a better life. But I do suggest that we must be much more practical in engaging with resistance and harm if we wish to change the world for the better. So this brings me to the question of human rights in relation to peace and conflict studies, the role of human rights. How can we get behavior to change? It was, in fact, nothing short of a revolution at the end of the Second World War that the world, such as it was then represented in 1945, adopted the United Nations Charter and committed us to a new world order of justice, peace, and development, anchored in a global rule of law, non-coercive use of force, pacific settlement of disputes, and amazingly, the respect for human rights. That was not part in human history of the codes of international relations or law. It's a relatively recent invention. It was an absolute shift in paradigm, no longer merely the Westphalian paradigm of sovereign equality of states or justice among states, but now a responsibility for justice within states for everyone, subject to jurisdiction and effective control of authorities. This became an era of shared security, of collective security, to quote the UN Charter, and of universal peace and development. The logic of the United Nations Charter, pronounced in its preamble, which you might recall begins to save succeeding generations from the scourge of war, and articulated in its first articles, notably the object and purpose of the Charter, is specifically to establish and maintain peace and security, to achieve respect for human rights, and to contribute to social progress. While peace and security are foundational, justice among and within states is instrumental. And only thereupon is economic and social development, social progress, attainable and valid, no longer at the expense of or the coercive exploitation of others. We, the peoples of the United Nations, determined to save succeeding generations from the scourge of war, which twice in our lifetime has brought untold sorrow to mankind. So that was the impetus. This concept of equality between states, between sovereign states, coupled with equal human beings guaranteed equal human rights, is the normative postulate of the contemporary international order. It is normative. It articulates standards of good and proper behavior, forming the basis of expectations amongst members of communities, the way we do things, when in Rome, do as Romans shall do. What will be judged as ought to be norms. Norms are part of the human or social condition, and they are defining of civilization. As human beings are moral beings, there is no norm-free space of human consciousness or interaction. We have norms permeating this room at the moment. Responsibility is dependent upon those norms. Order, prediction, planning. We are norm dependent. There are different kinds of norms. There are social norms, cultural norms, religious norms, legal norms. And there are different variations of those norms. Standards or patterns, ideal ones, instrumental ones in terms of conduct, constitutive ones in terms of status, prescriptions and proscriptions, express or implied, general specific, substantive procedural, binding, non-binding. We have hierarchies of norms, superior and inferior, rigid norms, elastic ones, thick and thin systems of norms. What is the relevance of norms for peace and conflict studies? Existing norms and consequences are keys to accurate conflict analysis, not least normative dissonance, conflict, where there is conflict. People of good moral conscience can disagree, can compete over scarce resources. Norms frame understandings. They frame our relations and our visions. They condition and shape moral or immoral conduct. And norms are dynamic. They evolve. We can develop norms. Norms are also instrumental themselves. They offer ways of behaving, constraining or facilitating. We bring up our children that way. Norms offer order, predictability on all levels. Norms manifest justice and virtue. They respond to chaos, uncertainty, and vulnerability. Norms resonate. People understand norms, religious norms, cultural norms. And I would suggest to you that norms may require some degree of translation or interpretation, which helps us reconcile apparent differences. Within the state, human rights has become a predominant normative framework. Article 1 of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights declares, or asserts, all human beings are born free and equal in dignity and rights. That's not a right, it's an assertion. One might argue it's manifestly empirically false, as I've already argued. But the essence of it is the assertion of essential and inherent and inalienable similarity of all human beings, that at root, at essence, we are all the same. And we all have the same risks and vulnerabilities to the conditions of life. Other fundamental norms of human rights include the principle of non-discrimination, expressed in the United Nations Charter, basically repugnance of arbitrary treatment, and the principle of equality, also expressed in the United Nations Charter. And not only equality in law, but equality in fact, and equality of opportunity. In addition, there is a normative content of development for the human being to fulfill potential and capacity, to use Amartya Sen's idea of capacitization. The United Nations Charter, I submit to you, has a constitutional character at the international level. Sovereignty is essentially a matter of exclusive jurisdiction within which each state is subject to the constraining power of the charter. The objects and purposes of the charter dictate the basis of the use of that exclusive jurisdiction, place limits on the use of force, duties of cooperation, and a hierarchy with regard to international law. Human rights in this order has a foundational, Kelsen term, a grundnorm foundational place. Dignity is a super norm. The individual human being is imbued by nature with inherent characteristics which compel every state and every authority to respect, protect, and fulfill. Protection requires active agency. There are different forms in which those authorities will take steps to manifest the protection of the human rights of anyone in any situation, in any particular jurisdiction. These are human rights. These are not distinct from, for example, civil rights issued by a particular state. In the last 40 or 50 years, we've witnessed a remarkable period of standard setting where the normative content has been given specificity across a range of instruments. The state knows its obligations with a high degree of clarity, and it's relatively easy to establish violations by simply applying those standards. In the context of conflict and peace and conflict studies, I'd like to juxtapose this normative framework of human rights to conflict analysis as opposed to human rights analysis. The peace and conflict actor, normally, if he follows the teachings of Professor Byrne and others, perform a conflict analysis of a situation. Who are the actors? What are the interests at play? What are the causes and relationships? What options exist? And so forth. A human rights analysis asks a series of quite significantly different questions. For example, what are the rights specifically? What are the persons subject to those rights? Which is the authority holding responsibility vis-a-vis those rights? And so forth. There are inherent challenges of human rights analysis, inherent even in the first article of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, insofar as it may not be the case that the state is always really able to fulfill those human rights. I'll give you the example of an increasing number of states, but for example, Niger, which has 70% of its population under the age of 15, in terms of its available resources, appears to be unable to provide more than 4 years of schooling to the population, which is about half of the international prescribed right to education. Human rights may also be adversarial in some respect. My human rights claimed against your human rights with regard to limited space, limited opportunities. We think in terms of rights holders and duty holders, victims versus violators, or victims versus perpetrators. In that respect, human rights also serve as some kind of constraint, even on negotiation in terms of conflict resolution. We think of human rights giving rise also to sanctions for culpability in terms of international criminal law, or compensation and reparation in terms of civil responsibility. And there is, of course, a huge gap between the standards of human rights and their realization. So in other words, what I'm saying here is that human rights are not benign. They offer us some solutions. They help us frame our analysis of situations, but they are also somewhat problematical as an instrument for peace and conflict resolution, at least in terms of negative peace. Human rights as a tool for conflict prevention, management, and resolution nonetheless offers us this analytical tool to reframe situations and positions and perspectives of actors. It offers us a language for common understanding of articulating grievances, a repository of general and specific solutions, not just options, but solutions in terms of very specific responses to particular violations or claims. For example, how to overcome discrimination, how to specifically address rights of the child, and so forth. And by placing a limit on negotiability, I would assert that that's not a bad thing, but a good thing. I was once struck by Roger Fisher, who claimed that anything is negotiable. If we only followed his little getting to yes book, we could negotiate anything. And I asked him if he was prepared to negotiate genocide or negotiate the rape of his daughter. So I'd suggest that not everything is negotiable, that there are fundamental limits on negotiability, and human rights help us place the limits on what is negotiable. And ultimately, human rights offer us a framework for responsibility, including accountability. I don't suggest that human rights are a panacea, and I certainly assert that they are not enough. We need to couple them with good governance, with the rule of law, and with real effective and sometimes use of force in the public interest. So, to bring to a conclusion some of my remarks, allow me to share, first of all, a few distinctions with regard to human rights and peace and conflict studies. Human rights asserts a universal, in terms of geography, in terms of our species, all human beings, a universal postulate, which is admittedly anthropocentric. I don't think that's necessarily bad, but I know that there are people in indigenous studies, for example, who would challenge that. Human rights eschew a range of distinctions, particularly about arbitrariness, about unrestrained use of force. And human rights, in terms of universality, strive also for equality in law and, in fact, for opportunity for all. Human rights are ultimately conceived for the individual, which is not to say that they do not take account of and even manifest rights for groups or communities, not only for minorities, for indigenous peoples, but for other groups, for example, private schooling. And in this respect, human rights are distinct from peace and conflict studies, which arguably are less universalist in their approach, are preoccupied with forms and degrees of groups, states, or organized armed conflict, thresholds of the use of force and violence, and so forth. In fact, the way that a lot of the science of peace studies has been conducted, and what used to be called polemology, the study of war, is counting battlefield deaths. I'm not even sure what a battlefield is anymore, of looking at hot and cold conflicts and so forth. So these are not perfectly reconcilable fields, is what I want to suggest for you. They have distinctions, but I think that they can that they are closely related, not the same, but closely related, and that there are important correlations between them and some causality or interdependence. The argument that that war is the absence of human rights has often been asserted, and that the idea that human rights would be a manifestation of peace, a fully respecting human rights society, and that human rights certainly depends on a degree of, full human rights depends on a degree of peace, and vice versa. I would certainly argue that positive, sustained peace, resilient societies able to manage differences or conflicts, is a form of peace and does require the broad respect of human rights in addition to the rule of law and to active participatory decision-making, forms of democratic governance, in other words. This said, we can imagine, and in fact have known, relatively peaceful societies and regions without armed conflict or war, where human rights are violated on a widespread, in a widespread basis. There are even some with shallow expressions of democratic governance, with the pretenses of separation of powers and so forth, but without the respective human rights, which are still nonetheless relatively peaceful. In fact, it's increasingly argued. It was just argued on some major. On Fareed Zakaria, if anyone watches that show, just the other day, as a kind of sudden realization that many people in places such as Syria and Iraq today would choose a dictatorial governance over the chaos and anarchy to which they're currently subjected. So we cannot just disregard and say that the absence of human rights that peace at all costs, for example, is meritorious. Still, an effective Weberian state, that is to say, the monopoly of the use of force, without human rights, is something that, it has been argued, is a necessary step of development. In other words, we don't have minimum levels of peace and security. It's very hard to construct investment, planning, and so forth for economic and social progress. Many over the last 25 years have argued that dictatorship, as I mentioned, is superior to chaos and anarchy. And that's been evidenced by some of the misguided interventions, which are often justified by good intentions, by liberation movements, and so forth, such as in Iraq, Libya, and South Sudan. So in conclusion, my suggestion for you this evening is that the role of human rights and peace and conflict studies is so far modest and often passing a cursory, but holds significant potential. Human rights remains a principal idea of the 20th century, of resistance and of liberation, and also for development in ordering of our societies in the pursuit of sustainable peace, well-being, and prosperity. It's full of tremendous potential that is yet to be realized. It's normatively valuable, and it's instrumentally essential. My personal preoccupation in the last number of years has been how to translate the application of human rights into effective means of peace and security, to establish peace in either the negative or positive sense. In my view, for peace and conflict studies, my recommendations for peace and conflict studies would be to incorporate human rights as an essential or core element of curriculum. It needs to be taught both in terms of the ideas and the norms, but also with a sense of context, of history, of pluralism, and the range of manifestations of human rights throughout the world. It also needs to be informed and honed through forms of practice, of action, of learning through doing, of experiences which give nuance and give nimbleness to the implementation of human rights in a range of situations. And further, it needs to be supplemented by the development of skills, not only to know, but to know how. In my view, such an investment in human rights within a peace and conflict studies, perhaps through grounded theory, bolstered by personal insights and experiences through field experiences, will yield a rich learning environment, a rich learning opportunity, and generate graduates who are able to contribute to our world in an effective manner to contribute to peace and conflict in negative or positive terms. Ultimately, we do need to know better, we do need to do better, and we hopefully will live better lives in the universal sense of which both human rights and peace are imagined for ourselves and for all. And I believe the role of human rights in peace and conflict studies can be a meaningful step in that direction. Thank you very much.
Stay up here for the Q&A.
Sure.
Yeah.
I now invite Tom Dooley, partner with Aikins Law, our longtime sponsor of this lecture, to come up and moderate. And Jason, I understand you're the microphone, so if you keep your questions short, but I'll let you go before, Tom.
Thank you, Christopher.
Nice to meet you.
And just like to say, apropos of your final comments, that I think it's wonderful that you as a Paulinian have come back to help enrich your community, college and university. So
thank you. My pleasure.
Good to be here.
Thank you.
The presentation was very, very rich in content, so it's a great opportunity now to have questions from the floor. I'll ask that you do address your questions forward, that it not become a dialogue back and forth. If you could possibly keep your question to a single question, if you need a little bit of follow-up or clarification, wonderful. But please give other people an opportunity to ask questions too. And I particularly encourage any students here that have spent time with Professor Packer today to continue to have a dialogue with them during tonight's Q&A. So first question, please, if you identify yourself and then just give a few seconds for Jason to get there with a microphone so that everybody can hear you. Jason,
the microphone is quite working at the moment, so maybe the first speaker can speak as loudly as clearly as they can, and we'll get the microphone going in just a second.
Okay.
I can repeat the question if I hear it for the recording.
That gentleman looks like he might have a projecting voice.
I'll see my voice is loud enough. I'm a PhD student in peace and conflict studies, and I had a very wonderful session with you this morning.
Thanks.
I like your presentation. Thank you so much. This evening, after our conversation, I went online and saw that the Senate in Nigeria rejected a bill to guarantee equal rights for women in Nigeria. So by that, all Nigerian women do not have equal rights with men, and my sister do not have equal rights with me. So what is the future of human rights in relation to peace and conflict, or peace and justice in a world where some societies cannot guarantee equal rights for women? Thank you.
So if I understand correctly, you were saying that you just went online and in Nigeria they adopted a law, or was it a constitutional amendment, or
that?
But there was a motion to guarantee equal rights for women, men and women in Nigeria. Mm-hmm. But the motion was rejected by the Senate. They do not want Nigerian women to have equal rights with men.
Okay. Well, that's a good example of kind of where we are in the world. I'm not an expert on Nigerian constitutional law. I assume you're talking at the federal level in Nigeria. It wasn't just a state, it was at the federal level. And I don't know the jurisdictional competence of the federal government, so how far that would reach. But obviously that's not consistent. I don't know what the Nigerian constitution prescribes. My guess is that there's already a non-discrimination provision and probably even an equality provision in the Constitution of Nigeria. I remember it was revised a few years ago when the Federation was altered. And I'd be very surprised if it does not include such a provision. But what I can tell you for sure is that both in terms of the United Nations and in terms of the African Union, Nigeria, and in terms of the Economic Committee of West, Community of West African States, so at least at the global, continental, and sub-regional level, Nigeria is already bound to international obligations for non-discrimination and equality on the basis of sex and gender. In other words, women and men. It's one of the few things in the UN Charter. The UN Charter only mentions three human rights expressly. So aside from self-determination, it mentions non-discrimination and equality, and with regard to equality, specifically mentions in terms of men and women. So the Charter is a treaty. Nigeria is a member state, a party to that treaty. So at a minimum, we now have, by that vote of the Senate, an inconsistency, a contradiction, one could argue a violation in law between Nigerian law and its international obligations. What does it reflect? It obviously reflects the public, the sentiment of those in power, at least in the Senate, with regard to the idea of equality. And I think that's where we have to engage in a discussion. So what are they doing by rejecting equality? What are they imagining in terms of normativity? What ought to be? What society do they imagine? And I think that's where a conversation needs to be engaged in. Let me just immediately say that even if Nigeria were to adopt a law declaring that there was equality, that doesn't mean there is equality, right? Because whatever these instruments say, the real question is on the ground. What happens in fact? And here we are in Canada. We have a Charter of Rights in our own constitution, at least since 1982. And for three quarters of, or 80% of Canadian history, we didn't have that. But at least since then, we do. But the question is, what does that mean in terms of lived experiences for those subject to the Constitution? In other words, all persons within Canada. And we have still substantial inequalities and discrimination. So that's the second step, is always the effective implementation of it. But I would like to know more, what are the arguments made by those who voted against? What are they imagining as a better life?
Over here. I guess we're not operating with the mic, so
we'll be
I think that we were discussing this in the morning in the student colloquium, but I want to raise the question again about a very important role of human rights in terms of justifying some conflicts, especially internal political conflict in certain countries, and how sometimes the people have the expectation of the involvement of the international community in order to respect the human rights. In order, because when and on sometimes the conflict, and in that sense, media is involved, lawyers are involved, investigation bodies are involved, because as much as a country or the opposition or the people that is fighting against certain established governments realize the violation or the massive violation of human rights, they can call the attention of the international community and find an exit to their situation. So how do you address the role of human rights in that kind of conflict?
So what you described is a common or is a phenomenon experienced around the world. There are a number. So first of all, human rights partly has its origin in resistance movement. So those persons who were subject to exclusion, we go back to the French Revolution, the American Revolution, the impositions of illegitimate power, whether it was colonial in the Americas or whether it was the king in France and so forth. So this idea, and in fact, there is a right to rebel. There is a right to oppose, and particularly to challenge authority and so forth. The problem is where we intersect this with violence and resort to force. And the kind of cases you're talking about, which would probably be quite extreme in the sense of not only patterns of gross and systematic violations of human rights, but widespread over time, give rise to questions about whether there is any either right of those suppressed to seek external assistance, whether the legitimacy of the authority is lost, and the implications of that. So this has been broadly discussed in the context of the responsibility to protect, at least since 2005 at the United Nations, and the idea that a number of states may be unwilling in terms of their governmental authority or unable in terms of their ability to respect, protect, fulfill human rights, among other things. And or there may be the agents of oppression. And if that's the case, so the argument goes, there's a residual duty on the international community in the form of the United Nations and specifically authorized by the Security Council to take steps to act within that otherwise sovereign jurisdiction. So that means the sovereignty is already diminished. There is no sovereign right to oppress. I mean, that's been well dealt with in terms of things like apartheid, where specific regimes have been identified as not only illegitimate, but in contradiction of fundamental principles of international law and politics. But to say that there's a breach or a contradiction with the standard does not tell us either what the sanction would be or who's the legitimate actor or recourse. This is one of the shortcomings of international relations and law. We don't actually have a place to go for those. So the call for international engagement intervention goes to whom exactly? Where do you bring a claim in the United Nations, for example? Which body do you go to? So you broadly mobilize, you hope CNN comes and takes some shots and so forth. And then we have the problem of who can intervene. And here's where the myth of sovereign equality is laid bare. So theoretically, the island state of St. Lucia is equally sovereign to the United States of America. But St. Lucia ain't going to intervene, you know, certainly not in the USA and definitely not in a lot of other places. Who can intervene? A very limited number of states, actually. And that's a slippery slope if it's not only those states who can, but those states who also happen to sit in the bodies that make the determinations of the legitimacy of the intervention. I'm talking about the Security Council. So we have five states, and we've seen this in Crimea. Russian Federation simply saying, yeah, we consider it, and there's been no resolution contrary because they would veto it. So this creates a conundrum. Now, I think that there's generally a problem of the use of force in this regard. What I would suggest is one way of addressing these situations, which we should all be more conscious of and active around, is much earlier in the kind of trajectory of, before we get to these extreme points of widespread systematic violations, there's so much that we could all be doing. You know, that we have to wait. I was working in February 2012, I was advising Kofi Annan as the first special envoy in Syria. At that point, there was only 6,000 deaths. They didn't really know, but they thought about 6,000 deaths. I figured that was still, that was a good number. 6,000's quite a few, I would say. But you think anyone was moved to act? No, not enough. I don't know what enough, still today we're up to 300,000, 11 million displaced and refugees. I'm not sure what enough is. But what I would say is intervening later and who can intervene and how to intervene becomes all the more problematical the longer you leave it. So there's a very big argument for so-called upstream early engagement, not necessarily intervention, but engagement to address these issues too. And this is really the work of human rights advisors, I would say, to the Canadian government. Instead of sending 6 airplanes to some place to drop some bombs at this point, why were we not involved a whole lot earlier in a lot of other ways, right? There's a lot we could have done. But I do think that your question also lays bare the other problem, which is the limited development of our international political organization. We don't have institutions, recourses at the moment to go to with these problems. We have politically interested limited number. So there's no happy response, actually.
Thank you. Thank you very much for your talk, Professor. You spoke in some detail about norms. And so building human rights upon this normative paradigm. And you also spoke about there are the shameless people in the world. So obviously everybody is not on the same page. And so I was wondering in the context of the work that you do and your own response to aspects like ideology, subjectivity, cultural relativism, what is like human rights from whose perspective? So, like who's, and again, you also talk about sovereignty, like relations, how can you intervene? You're not, So how would you, if any specific example from your work where you kind of encountered, I'm sure you did, many of these dilemmas. So,
So first of all, in terms of norms, so I started to work for the United Nations in the 1980s, initially with the High Commission for Refugees and the International Labour Organization. 1990, as I mentioned, Saddam invaded Iraq and Kuwait and so forth, and I started to work there. And I thought, nice kid from the prairies, that these were kind of self-evident things, and that of course these were good things, and I believed in this kind of mobilization of shame. If only people knew, if they could only be exposed, well, of course we would all see. Then you discover it's just not true, and that, by the way, a lot of people know already, and they're not moved to act, and so forth. In that respect, our world is a harsh world. I was totally flabbergasted to discover inside the United Nations, if you ask why are the human rights institutions in Geneva, one of the answers is because it's pretty far away from New York. And New York is where the Security Council and the power is. And I was shocked to discover at that time under Kofi Annan, Kofi Annan was against, absolutely against, I personally was involved with him, he was a professor of international law, incidentally. He was against discussing human rights in the Security Council. His view and the received wisdom at the time was that human rights was not a peace and security issue. That was a third committee, meaning economic and social development question, to be discussed in nice places like Geneva and elsewhere. Peace and security, that hard stuff, that was political affairs, that's New York. And there should the twain meet. And the people in the political affairs department, didn't exist, by the way, in 1990, but it was created under Kofi Annan, and I subsequently have worked with them. For a long time, the orthodox view was not to engage with those human rights people are problem causers. They're drawing attention to, they're going to make it difficult for us to negotiate. They're going to draw attention. We want to make deals with the criminals. I don't know if you know who the Prime Minister of Kosovo is, and now going to run for and likely become president, a guy named Mr. Thaci. But this is a guy who was involved in organ sales, killing refugees and children and buying and selling organs and so forth. But we deal with these guys, right? I'm not saying, I mean, there's some nasty people in the world you might have to deal with. But I would say that we cannot disconnect things a lot, because if you, this idea of normative neutrality, then where are we in normative neutrality? That to me is basically might means right. That's just whoever's got the most money or the biggest stick, you know, or prestige or whatever. So I think, you know, we can't disconnect this. And I mean, I've been at conferences even last year in South Africa with the conflict resolution community, who there's a very standard view that norms are problematical for conflict resolution. Keep them out. It complicates life. Identifying who's bad and good and done right and wrong and so forth. Now, in terms of all these issues like cultural relativism and so, without getting all into that, I'll tell you something from my personal experience professionally and kind of on the ground. So two quick things. One is, in 1993, there was the last World Conference on Human Rights. I was working for the United Nations, and I had the privilege to be in the organizing committee, and I was actually in the drafting committee, too. It was held in Vienna. But before the Vienna World Conference, June 1993, there were a series of regional conferences around the world. These were, of course, intergovernmental conferences, meaning diplomats and politicians, people with money and power. And alongside them were popular fora of civil society, NGOs, and others. And it was very hard to get them together. They didn't get to sit in the same room, unlike in Paris just recently on the climate change summit. And I remember specifically the meeting in Bangkok in Southeast Asia. The governments had their meeting, and Thailand was sufficiently open to allow civil society to come, so there was a really big other meeting of civil society. And the governments got together and they adopted a declaration which said, you can look it up, Bangkok Declaration, saying they were absolutely against conditioning trade and aid arrangements on respect for human rights, because that interfered with sovereignty and it was abuse of power by the traders and all the rest of it. You know what? Public forum of the NGOs, they all got together and they said, please condition trade and aid on human rights. Because if you don't link these things, we're totally vulnerable. So one of my questions is, who are you talking to and what are you talking about, right? I mean, this idea of cultural relativity and so forth, in my experience, the directly affected people, they are very interested in their human rights. They are not only claiming them, they are working for their vindication. It's governments and certain people in positions of authority that tend to, you know, muddy the waters in this regard. My second point in this regard is, I have found that the postulate of universality is borne out on a very human level. I've had the privilege of working in many, many countries of the world and at very grassroots level, going into small communities, interviewing victims, not speaking languages and so forth, but there are some really remarkable elements of universal human nature, of respect for the older person, of hospitality. You know, I've been in refugee camps and with deprivation, but you'll be offered a cup of tea, because the idea of hosting and having some dignity and being able to offer, and this idea of human dignity is immediately recognizable. I mean, I've got three kids. Who's got kids here? Do your kids not know immediately, if you treat them differently in an arbitrary way, that that's just unfair? You know, my kids are really sharp on that. Daddy, why did they get this and I didn't get that? I mean, arbitrary treatment is universally recognizable, and it's repugnant. If it's arbitrary, not justified, you know, I don't like it. And why should I be subject to that? And I've heard that in Southeast Asia and South Asia and Eastern Europe and Africa and everywhere else. It's a universal thing. So I think we recognize, we also know what ridicule is. We know what indignity is. So I would suggest that there are these elements, and I think if we approach it at a popular level, that that we can overcome these kind of obstacles.
Thank you. When you were making the comment about someone being a candidate for presidency, I wondered where you were going to go next.
Yes, and indignities. Yeah.
There was a gentleman at the back of the room. I
believe, that had a stand up. Jason, who was that?
One over here.
Hello, thank you.
Yeah, we'll go with the gentleman in the back.
But thank you very much for coming out tonight and giving us this presentation. It's really appreciated. My name is Joseph Chris. I'm a student here at the college, and my question to you tonight is about sovereignty, peace, and relationship to human rights. You mentioned in your presentation about how repugnant it is for people to experience unequal treatment or arbitrary discrimination. I completely agree with that. My question to you is that, given that you also mentioned in your presentation that sovereignty is one way of accomplishing peace, and it's not necessarily associated all the time with a respect for human rights, and given that peace is generally preferable to a state of chaos, which entails a lack of sovereignty, or which is entailed by a lack of sovereignty. When we look at human rights, they're one of the few international normative things that we have, and they are normative on an international level. And so when they are enforced, often at that level, this can lead to a reduction of sovereignty, either well-intentioned or perhaps more coercive by various actors under the flag of human rights. I was wondering if you had any thoughts on the reduction of sovereignty and potential for increased conflict where people try to enforce these normative human rights on the international level.
Well, sure. I think that's, by the way, often called interventionism, sometimes called liberal interventionism. You know, and there are there's a whole school of thought around that. There are some very well-known liberal interventionists, one of them a Canadian named Michael Ignatieff. He's written a lot about this, the justifications for intervention. Samantha Powers, the American ambassador, I spent a year, was mentioned as a fellow at Harvard University, the Kennedy School, with Michael Ignatieff and Samantha Powers, by the way. And they're quite sure that it's totally okay to, you know, and whether that's part of a kind of civilizing mission idea, we're going to go help people realize. I would also suggest it's highly problematical. You know, I give you the moral of the, you know, the China shop. You go in and you break it, it's yours. You know, you better be ready to take it. That's not always their claim. They imagine some kind of, we don't talk about Darfur anymore, but Darfur, for your information, you know, is the size of France. And how we're going to go into Darfur, who's the we, by the way? But if we're going to go into Darfur, so there's this whole liberal interventionism, Libya, the responsibility to protect, Libya is such an example. And I think there's an audacity to that, but it's also just problematical. You know, you better be ready, if you're going to go in, to be there for the long haul, to establish the rule of law, to respect everybody's human rights. We're not. No, we're very happy to go into the short haul or do a bombing escapade or whatever we did. What we did in Canada is we did a fueling exercise. We fueled the jets that bombed. And we did some targeting and other stuff, you know, and then we left. Well, that was very helpful. So, nothing to say in the defense of Gaddafi, although there's a whole interesting story about Gaddafi, but, you know, I'm no defender of Gaddafi. I'm no defender of Saddam Hussein. I remember the first time I met Tariq Aziz, who was the deputy prime minister at the time, and he said, and I quote you him now, he said, "You people will lament the day we're gone because we're holding this place together." His words. Now, that's not a justification. Yeah, go ahead and hold it together with all impunity, you know. But at the same time, it's a cautionary tale, right? Be careful what you're talking about. Now, about sovereignty. I mean, this is a long discussion, but let me just say in quick order that this word is very easy to invoke. It's not clear what we mean by it. Its particular origins I can tell you about. But my own understanding of sovereignty, it's invoked as a trump of power. No one else can interfere here and so forth. There's very little exclusivity of in terms of our complex interdependent world now. In terms of, we are all of conditioned and moderate sovereignty, every state in the world. We don't have this fictional idea of independence. Who's independent? Is the U.S., even is the U.S. Treasury independent at the moment? You know, they better watch how many dollars they're printing because of the implications for trade and who's holding them overseas. This idea of pure sovereignty is a kind of fiction. I would go further than that to say that the Westphalian, meaning the 17th century idea of equal sovereignty of states, We're living now in a post-Westphalian world. We're way past, and that was a deal between princes. Let's be honest here. There was no democratic decision out of that. It was 128 princes or something got together and said, you know, let's make a deal. I won't interfere with you, you don't interfere with me, you know. That was the deal. There was no good thought, there was no human rights. I mean, that we often look back with, oh, the human rights. No, there were no human rights in 1648. So let's get over the sovereignty thing, and let's talk about the facts that we live in a complex interdependent world, and then let's talk about what are our actual effects and possibilities of affecting, and what may be our responsibilities. So that's part of the discussion with regard to Syrian refugees. We're not part of the causation. We didn't cause the Syrian refugee crisis, but it's a real thing in the world in which we're really living, and it affects all sorts of, not just morally, but I mean, it really does affect stability, economy, and so forth. What's our relationship to that? What are our possibilities for that? We're doing something about it. We didn't used to, we're now doing something. I don't know if you know what we used to do a year ago. Does anyone know what our commitment was as a country on Syria? The total commitment of Canada under the last government in the last year was 1,200 refugees. Only 300 were government sponsored. 900 were you guys. Okay, that was the total commitment of our country to the total situation. Now, my view is that's pretty minuscule response to the nature of the problem. Now, is 25,000 better? Obviously, it's better. Is it sufficient? And should we take a million? No, I'm not arguing we take a million. But somewhere in this complex world we live in, we should be asking ourselves, what is our relationship? What are our possibilities? What is our responsibility? And I would get kind of over the sovereignty question.
I think Jason, I got two. Okay, Jason, you are the individuals.
And we will have not working because it's going into the speaker for the video. So I'll pass the microphone even though he's not going to actually, okay. We're not going to hear his voice. So nice and loud, please.
Hello, good evening, sir, and thanks for such an amazing talk. I have two linked questions. They're kind of interlinked. First of all, how does human rights issue that is in conflict with people's religious ideas? We see that in the case of, like my colleague says, in Nigeria, that some people believe that women are inferior to men. And with the case of human rights and religious ideas, I want to know how the UN sees the case of Israel and Palestinian conflict, because in papers and issues of the world, it's like, Israel actually committed a human rights abuse with the war in Palestine, with Palestine. And it's like Israel is claiming a divine right to the land. So how does the UN tackle those issues? And what is your idea about it? Thank you.
Do you want to respond immediately to that? Yeah. Or take the second question. Did I get the first?
Yeah.
Can I just clarify the beginning of the first question? Was it human rights and religion? Is that what you were asking about? Yeah, okay.
Maybe address those questions first.
Well, I'm not quite sure about the question of the relationship of human rights to religion. Okay, so that's relatively easy in terms of human rights. So. It might strike you as strange, but in terms of when I say the positive catalog of human rights, I mean those that are actually articulated and adopted, such as in the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. You and I could talk about all sorts of things. We'd like to have a human right to tourism. The World Tourism Organization, about 25 years ago, adopted a resolution claiming a human right to tourism, but it doesn't really exist. All sorts of things we'd like to have could be human rights, but they're not. However, there is a freedom of religion. In fact, one of the four freedoms that Roosevelt articulated was freedom of thought, freedom of belief, religion. So amongst the lexicon, or the catalog rather, of human rights, very few human rights are absolute. Generally, my human rights end where they interfere with your human. Your freedom of movement ends at least where it interferes with my freedom of movement. You don't have a right to displace me. But we both have a freedom of religion, a freedom of movement. So this is a correlation between ourselves, okay? And there's all sorts of conditions and limits on it. But there are a number, about a half a dozen, maybe 10, absolute human rights. For example, torture is absolutely prohibited under all circumstances everywhere. There are some disputes about how you define it. Slavery is absolutely prohibited, forced labor and slavery and so forth. One of the absolute human rights is the freedom of thought and religion or belief in what's called its internal sense, in my head. I can believe anything. I can believe I'm God. I can believe I fly. You have no right, and the state has no right, to impede on my absolute freedom of whatever I want to believe. What I do with that belief in terms of manifestations of it, how I act, so religious practices and so forth, then we have limits. There's various things I cannot do. Again, they might interfere with your rights and so forth. So human right and religion, it's quite important because in history, and in fact the Westphalian idea, was that the king determined the religion. The king determined the belief of the population. And part of the treaties at the end of 1648 were to say, well, actually, at least with regard to Protestantism, the king might not determine all religion. Okay? But at the time and into much of the world, we used to do it. What you thought, the state, the king, could tell you what you had to think. Okay? And they'd have ways of forcing and so forth. So I don't, to tell you very honestly, in a practical sense, I don't really care what anybody thinks in this internal perfect sense. You can have all sorts of beliefs that you're more important than the other person or whatever. I do care, you should care, how we behave to each other. Okay? So that then raises an issue about the freedom of religion in terms of its manifestation. Not only rituals and things like that, but actions based on religious beliefs, such as women are inferior to men, if that is a religious belief. I'm not even sure it is. All sorts of groups invoke that, and they say, oh, my religion says, and then you kind of, well, where does it say? Then you discover it doesn't actually say that. So I think that's reconcilable relatively easily in terms of human rights. Human rights does not offer a trump to religions to invoke any belief to overcome the human rights of others. Now, in terms of Israel and Palestine, the position of the United Nations is relatively simple and has been since long, long ago. I can't remember the resolution, 247 or something, I think it is. According to the United Nations, in terms of member states, Israel is illegally occupying the Palestinian territories that they did not have granted to them in terms of out of the mandate at the birth of the state of Israel. And this has continued to be the case, and therefore there are procedures and mechanisms which continually supervise the illegal occupation of Israel of the occupied Palestinian territories, OPT. And of course, Israel has been, and this is part of the ongoing conflict, increasingly building and extending its state representation within these occupied territories, so hardly surrendering or relieving of them. That's the UN position. My kind of innocent observation, and I've been there, yeah, it looks like they're illegal, like they're occupied. That sure looks like that to me. What to do about it? Well, you know, there's been decades of peace processes and trying to reconcile. It's not been working. What do we do in the alternative? Well, that's really slippery slope, you know. Intervention, what does that mean? Who, how, and so forth. I would say, you know, one of the lessons is don't take, you know, hard cases make bad laws. And all that. I wouldn't say that because of the failure of the conundrum of the Israeli-Palestinian situation, therefore we have no lessons from the rest of international law. Yeah, it's a problem. I think it's going to be an ongoing problem. You know, I'm not very hopeful for a near-term solution. In the long term, what I would say is that any persistent violator of any normative standard is in for trouble over the long term. And I think Israel is feeling it in terms, you know, not only in terms of the region, but increasingly, European states and others are finding it simply untenable, decade after decade after decade, to allow or to be part of or to be passive in the face of this ongoing occupation. So some kind of other resolution should be necessary. Sorry.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Hi, good evening. My name is Christina, and thank you so much for your presentation. And at some point, you mentioned that the state has kind of the obligation to provide human rights for its civilian. And my question to you is, like, through your personal experience, how can we address or assure human rights on in failed or collapsed states regarding its sovereignty? Thank you.
Collapsing states. So that's a great question. You know, one of the problems of the world in which we're living in now, I mentioned it today to some of the students that last time I looked at the, there's, I think it's Transparency International, but someone else can correct me. Fragility Index, I don't know if you've looked at this, but this comes from a speech about 20 years ago that Madeleine Albright gave, where she classified a number of governments and states and situations as failed, fragile, failing, and rogue. You might remember the rogue ones, right? And then there was the axis, that was subsequent to the axis of evil. There were all these kind of simple classifications. But what she was really saying is that, you know, the idea that we can look to states and hold them responsible, which is a key element of international relations. That, you know, if we go to the United States, as many Canadians do, we're subject to the sovereign jurisdiction and authority of the United States. We should, as in Rome, follow the laws, but also we should expect the United States of America to also respect not only our human rights, but we are there as Canadian citizens. Even the government of Canada should expect to hold the United States of America responsible for their conduct vis-a-vis Canadian citizens. Okay? And by the way, Canada has a right to exercise what's called diplomatic protection if we feel that our citizens are not protected in that context. But that implies, or that imagines, that the state is capable of being responsible. And the problem that we're observing that Madeleine Albright and other people talked about is increasingly we have states. I think we always did have some states, but increasingly we have states in the world that are not capable. They are these failed, fragile, and so forth. I've been, unfortunately, in a number of these places, Somalia, to give one example. Where, you know, or I spent a lot of 2012 to 2014, I spent a lot of my time in Yemen. Now, Yemen, there's no doubt it's a state, but it's, you know, the writ of the state is pretty thin in most parts of the state, backed up by any kind of accountable power and so forth. There's not much to rely upon. You know, have to rely on other things, tribes and so forth. A lot of the world is like this now. And it's kind of scary to be in places where you're not sure who you can rely upon. We walk down the street, you all get in your cars tonight, you drive home, you kind of expect the state is doing its function somehow. The roads are in order, if they fail, you can hold someone to account, you know, and all the rest of it. But if you're living in an environment where that's not the case, then you're very, very vulnerable. Now, your question is, what do we do in the face of those kind of contexts? Well, this is a problem. We're increasingly living in a world where we have more and more of these states that are failed, fragile. I think the State Fragility Index identifies something like 75 out of 200 states in that category. And there are many parts of other states that are partially failed or fragile and so forth. And that, in our complex interdependent world, becomes a big problem for us. I mean, that was the problem of Al-Qaeda relocating out of the Arabian Peninsula to Afghanistan. Why? Because the state in Afghanistan, and I worked there in the early 1990s with the UN Special Rapporteur on Human Rights in Afghanistan, was basically dissolved. There was almost no state. It was very easy for Al-Qaeda to set up, have a location, and use the facilities and so forth for whatever it wanted to do. And that became a very direct threat, a manifest threat, you know, to other parts of the world, obviously 9/11. So yeah, we have to think about those places. It's at our peril that there is increasingly so many parts of the world that are in this category. Now, what to do about it? Well, little old Canada with 35 million people, and you know, we're not going to solve that problem alone, absolutely not alone. We can't even pick small pieces of it alone. In my view, this really underlines the kind of nature of the world we live in now. We absolutely need an international order that we can also rely upon in terms of our safety, our security, the environment. I mean, there's many things. The Ebola crisis, if you look at the causes of the Ebola crisis, it was basically the collapse of the healthcare systems in West African states. That's what happened. So do we care about, I was arguing, why do we care? Do we care about how Sierra Leone deals with its health? We better care, because we're one flight away. And that's the truth. So how do we deal with that? We have to think about how we invest, how we organize, in terms of interstate cooperation. One interesting thing about the United Nations Charter, and I'll end on this, is Wolfgang Friedman at the end of the Second World War, he was a displaced German Jew who went to, like many did, to New York City, and he taught law at Columbia University. He imagined what he called transnational law, and he established a journal called the Columbia Journal of Transnational Law. It's still published today. And he said, you know, we've got to get over this idea of these kind of discrete, separate states and realize it's not just international law, this idea that there's little places where we intersect. No, we are much more integrated like this, and we have to think about transnational law. And here we have to think about what's our relationship and what's the political and legal structures through which our interests that do touch or reach that far, and vice versa, can actually be managed. What kind of world order? And the essence of that is cooperation. We absolutely have to cooperate. We are not going to solve environmental threats, global health pandemics, terrorism and security threats, and many, many other problems in the absence of a very active cooperation. And that's really the only thing that's left to us.
Thank you. Thank you very much. In addition to your academic writings, you're going to have to read your memoirs.
Thank you. That's very nice. Pleasure to meet you. Thank you very much.
Thanks, John. I would now like to ask. Rodriguez da Costa, a doctoral student here in the Peace and Conflict Studies program, to bring a few brief words of appreciation. Thank you, Dr. Eduardo, for intercessions.
I did. You subjected me to an anonymous.
Thank you. Thank you, Professor Parker. Thank you so much for your presentation. It is my pleasure to give you a gift on as a PhD student here in the Peace and Conflict Studies program on behalf of St. Paul's College to thank you for sharing your knowledge, your experience with us today. It's a book, a recently published history of St. Paul's College. And as you mentioned earlier, this is your alma mater. So thank you for coming back home. But before I give you this book, I would like to say a few words about books and about presentations like this one. I once heard that two people will never be able to read the same book. Because even if they read the same book, they have different eyes. They have different backgrounds, different worldviews. So, in fact, they'll never read the same book. So if this concept is true, I would argue that none of us here in this audience today attended the same talk. I come from Brazil. As I was listening to your words, I was thinking of human rights issues, violations in Brazil, my home country, a country where human rights violations are committed on a daily basis against the poor, the underprivileged, the people of color, the voiceless. More specifically, the place where I come from, the Brazilian Amazon rainforest, an example. In the last 10 years, over 500 environmental activists and indigenous leaders were murdered in the Brazilian Amazon rainforest. And as you mentioned, I was an economist, I like averages. That's an average of four per month, one per week, over the last 10 years. So I want to thank you for bringing me back home with your words. And because you brought me back home, you brought me back to Brazil. I want to thank you the Brazilian way. And in Brazil, we give a hug to say hello. We hug people to say goodbye. And we also hug people to say thank you. And the reason why Brazilians hug so much, I'll let you know, it's because I do believe that when you hug a person, there's scientific evidence physical and even visual evidence. When you hug a person, your heart gets closer to the other person's heart. And as a Brazilian, I want to thank you for bringing your mind closer to our minds today, bringing your knowledge closer to our knowledge, and bringing your heart closer to our hearts today. Thank you so much. I'll give you the book and a generous Brazilian hug.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you very much. Now we hug. Thank you. Thanks. Do we get the hug?
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you for being here this evening. I want to give a special thank you to Jason Brandon, who did a lot of the coordinating work. This evening, I'd like to thank John Packer for leading us with this great discussion. I would now like to invite you all to join us for light refreshments out in the foyer. So thank you, John.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.